हेलो एवरीवन, दिस लेक्चर इज़ द कंटिन्यूशन ऑफ द स्लाइडिंग कॉन्टैक्ट बियरिंग, स्पेशली जर्नल बियरिंग। वी हैव स्टडीड प्रीवियसली व्हाट इज़ द जर्नल बियरिंग, व्हाट आर द थिक एंड थिन फिल्म बियरिंग्स, व्हाट आर द इफेक्ट ऑफ विस्कोसिटी। देन वी हैव स्टडीड द हाउ द कोफिशिएंट ऑफ फ्रिक्शन इज कैलकुलेटेड using Petrov's equation, and what are the observation of Mackey brothers on coefficient of friction in indirectly the effect of friction. In previous lecture, two important parameter we have defined, that is the mu n upon p, which is called bearing characteristics number, and another is r upon c, that is the ratio of journal radius and clearance. In this lecture, we are going to study the heat generated in the bearings and what will be the effect of that heat generated in the performance of bearing. We all know that due to the friction, heat is generated. Heat is generated in sharing the film of lubrication. If the case is of thick film lubrication, then the heat is generated due to the shearing of the film of lubrication. Because in thick film lubrication or in thick film lubrication bearing, it is assumed that it is a requirement that the quantity of lubricant will be such that sufficient quantity of the lubricant is required, because it is a thick film lubrication. So quantity of lubrication is required in sufficient quantity, and it is assumed that in the analysis of journal bearing that there is no any shortage of, or you can say that there is adequate supply of lubricant in the bearing. In that case, means in the case of thick film lubrication, there is no metal to metal contact, so friction due to the metal to metal contact does not occur. In that case, in the case of thick film lubrication, the friction occurs in sharing the film of lubrication. So in journal bearing of thick film type, the heat is generated in sharing the film of lubrication. That heat is due to the friction of lubricant. Here lubrication word is not suitable. Here word required is lubricant. Heat is generated in sharing the film of lubricant. So in case of thick film, heat is generated by sharing the film of lubricant. Due to this heat generated, and what will be the heat generated, I will discuss in second slide. Here it is sufficient to know that heat is generated due to the friction, and that friction is the sharing the film of lubrication, and it will be equal to the friction between the lubricant and the surface. Now the heat generated, this heat generated must be dissipated, because if it is not dissipated, then overheating of bearing occurs, and due to this overheating, the bearing performance will be adversely affected. So if the heat generated, so the heat generated must be dissipated to avoid overheating of bearing at high temperature. At elevated temperature, there is fall in viscosity of lubricant. We all know that when the temperature increases, the velocity, the viscosity decreases. So at the elevated temperature, due to the heat generation, temperature will rise, and at that elevated temperature, there is fall of viscosity of lubricant. Now, due to this fall of viscosity, makes the oil to squeeze out, and due to this squeezing, resulting in the negligible lubrication. That means it comes to the boundary lubrication, or we can say metal to metal contact, due to the squeezing of the oil at elevated temperature, because the viscosity of lubricant gets fall down, and due to this, consequently seizing of bearing occurs, and due to this metal to metal contact, after the squeezing the lubricant, seizing of bearing occurs. So this heat generated must be addressed to make the bearing performance satisfactory. The factor which limits better performance of bearing is the heat dissipation capacity of the bearing. Means the heat generated in the bearing must be dissipated for the better performance of the bearing. So first see the what is heat generated. Heat is generated in the bearing due to friction, shear force of lubricant due to viscosity. Means it is the friction between the lubricant and the surface, and this friction can be written as frictional force equal to F into W. We know that the frictional force is, in the normal notation, it is the mu into N, where mu is the coefficient of friction and N is the normal reaction. But here mu is used to represent viscosity, so coefficient of friction is represented here by the small f, and N, which is the normal reaction, it is due to the force, and the force is bearing. So frictional force can be written as small f into W, where small f is the coefficient of friction, W is the bearing load. Now heat generated can be written as this frictional force multiplied by velocity. If you see here the balance of units, before going to the balance of unit, you see here heat generated is represented by Hg, heat generated. And F, this will be equal to coefficient of friction F into bearing load W into velocity. The unit of frictional force is coefficient of friction is unitless. W is the load, so suppose its unit is Newton, and unit of velocity will be meter per second. So unit becomes Newton meter per second. Newton meter can be written as joule. So units becomes joule per second. It means the heat generated here is written in joule per second, and joule per second is the watt. Here it is the rate of heat generated is joule per second. So by the unit balance, we have seen here the Hg, here is the rate of heat generated, means joule per second. Now this V is the rubbing velocity, and it can be written as 2 pi r n, where r is the radius of journal or shaft, and n is the rps of shaft. So this equation becomes Hg equal to 2 pi r f w n, or you can write 2 r as the diameter, so pi d f w n. And this is the heat generated, or rate of heat generated in the bearing. In this equation, if you want the rate of heat generated in joule per second, means watt, then you have to put the unit of D in meter, value of W bearing load in Newton, and revolution of shaft in RPS, revolution per second, means all are in SI unit. Then you will get the rate of heat generated in joule per second. So this is the equation, very simple equation, Hg equal to pi d f w n. this is the heat generated. Now the temperature of lubricant rises until the rate at which heat is generated due to friction is same as the rate at which heat is transferred to surroundings. Means we can say that the heat generated in the bearing must be transferred to the surroundings, otherwise the temperature of lubricant get rise, and the rise in temperature we have already seen what is the effect on bearing. Bearing performance get deteriorate. So the rate at which heat is generated, when the rate of heat generated will be equal to rate at which the heat is transferred to surrounding, that condition is called equilibrium condition. Here you remember the Mackey brothers curve, where the operating point is denoted by P in region CD, if you remember. And that operating point P, we have explained there that this P does not change its position, means operating condition does not change. If due to the operation other parameter changes, the operating point P does not change because it is in equilibrium condition. And what is equilibrium condition? The heat generated, the rate of heat generated must be equal to the rate of heat transferred to surroundings. Now heat transferred to surrounding, now heat transferred to surrounding can be achieved by two ways generally, by flow of lubricant and by dissipation from bearing housing. In first method, by flow of lubricant, it is assumed that the lubricant comes in the bearing and pick up the heat and carry with itself when it exits. So by flow of lubricant, the generated heat can be transferred to surrounding. Another method is by dissipation from bearing house, means when the heat is generated, it results into the rise of temperature of lubricant and subsequently the rise of temperature of bearing house. So heat can be dissipated from the bearing house to the surrounding. Or the combination of these two also may occur. So the heat transferred to surrounding, the heat is transferred to surrounding by either flow of lubricant or by dissipation from bearing housing, or combination of these two. Generally, this is the general method to dissipate the transfer the heat generated to the surroundings. We will see further in the next slide where this method is used, where this method is used. Here it is written self-contained bearing. So this method is used in self-contained bearing. Self-contained means the reservoir of lubricant or sump of lubricant is within the bearing. It is not the outside of the bearing. In that case, the reservoir or sump get heated or its temperature get raised. In that case, the heat is dissipated from the bearing house due to radiation or convection. And this method, flow of lubricant, generally used in pressure fed bearing, where there is a greater heat generation. And for the greater heat generation, the flow rate of lubricant needs to be increased, because increased flow rate can carry more heat. So a pressure is employed to the lubricant, means lubricant is injected into the bearing at high pressure so that the flow rate can be increased, and the increased flow rate can carry more heat to the surrounding. If the lubricant is injected at high pressure, so it is called pressure fed bearing. It is not necessary to flow the lubricant at high pressure. In some cases, the lubricant is injected naturally, not at high pressure. In this case also, the lubricant is capable to carry the heat, but if you apply the lubricant or inject the lubricant at high pressure, it is capable to carry more heat. So generally this is used in pressure fed bearing, and this is used in self contact bearing. But in our case, journal bearing, and we are studying journal bearing. In journal bearing, generally pressure is not applied. So in case of journal bearing, the flow of lubricant is at atmospheric pressure. It enter into the bearing at atmospheric pressure, means there is no any extra pressure, and comes out from the bearing with the temperature get rise, and how much temperature get rise, it will see, we will see in the next slide. So here it is sufficient to know that the heat generated must be transferred to surrounding to increase the performance of bearing, and the heat transferred to surrounding can be obtained by these two methods or combination of these two methods. Now heat transferred by flow of lubricant, first see the heat transferred by flow of lubricant. In case of heat transferred by flow of lubricant, there may be two cases, with side leakage or without side leakage. Means we see this figure. This is the case of journal bearing. This is the journal, this is the bearing. Here this is the reservoir of lubricant. Lubricants go into the bearing, and after lubricating the parts of bearing, it comes out again to the reservoir. And suppose here it is shown, it is the side leakage. Sometimes the lubricant go into the bearing, and due to the motion of the bearing, motion of the journal, some lubricant get leakage from the side, so it is called side leakage. This the side leakage also come into the reservoir. So we can say that in case of short bearing or short journal, the side leakage is the problem. If the bearing is long, or we can say that the journal is long or bearing is long, the side leakage problem is not observed. So here it is written without side leakage in the case of long bearing. So heat transferred by flow of lubricant has two cases, with side leakage, without side leakage. First see the with side first here we have explained here without side leakage. Without side leakage, let us consider the total heat generated in the bearing due to friction is carried out by lubricant flow alone. Means there is no case of combination of these two methods. It is assumed that the lubricant is itself sufficient or capable to carry all the heat generated. This is the assumptions. So suppose consider the total heat generated is carried out by lubricant flow. In this case, total heat generated will be equal to heat carried out by the lubricant. And the heat, how much heat is carried out by the lubricant, can be easily calculated by this equation, m dot into Cp into delta T. where m dot is the mass of lubricant, mass rate of lubricant, and Cp you know that the specific heat at constant pressure or constant pressure of lubricant, delta T is the rising temperature of the lubricant. This m dot means mass flow rate of lubricant can be written in the term of density multiplied by lubricant flow Q. The density, the unit of density is kg per meter cube. The unit of flow of lubricant is meter cube per second. So m dot is the kg per second, means mass of the rate of mass of the lubricant. Kg per second means rate of mass of lubricant, and or you can say it is the rate of mass flow, and Q is the rate of lubricant quantity, rate of flow of lubricant quantity, meter cube volume. So this m dot can be calculated by the density multiplied by flow of lubricant. Now easily the mass flow rate can be calculated from this equation, heat generated upon Cp into delta T. Sometimes when this assumption does not valid, means the total heat generated is not carried out by completely by the lubricant flow, then some temperature rise occurs in the bearing. This is expressed in temperature rise parameter. When total heat is not carried out by the lubricant, then the temperature of bearing will increase, and it is accounted by the temperature rise parameter. And what will be the temperature rise parameter? This Hg upon Hc. If you put the Hg upon Hc equal to 1, it is the case of this. Total heat generated is carried out by the lubricant flow. If this case does not occur, means when the total heat is not carried out by the lubricant, then this Hg upon Hc temperature rise parameter has some value, and it will be greater than 1, because total heat is not carried out by the lubricant. Okay, this is the case. In more detail we will see in numericals. Now here written, it is a trick to solve numericals. If in question the density and Cp is not given, then you can assume that the density of lubricant is 860 kg per meter cube and Cp is 1760 joule per kg degree centigrade, because this value is valid for many of lubricants which is used in general use. So now come to the this is the case of without side leakage, means this without side leakage means for long bearing. When the side leakage occurs, then this is the case of with side leakage. Here some quantity is leaked here into the reservoir. Suppose m dot mass is going into the bearing, and ms mass of lubricant is leaked to the reservoir. So the returning lubricant will be m minus ms. Suppose the lubricants enter into the bearing at temperature T1 is the initial temperature, or you can say the temperature at which the lubricant enter into the bearing T1, and the lubricant will return at higher temperature. Suppose this higher temperature is T1 plus delta T. The temperature of lubricant gets increased by delta T. And the side leakage, the MS is leaked into the reservoir at temperature T1 plus delta T upon 2. It is assumed that the side leakage occurs at average temperature of entering temperature and returning temperature, means average of T1 and T1 plus delta T. So it comes T1 plus delta T upon U. It is assumed to solve the problem. So the side leakage occurs at temperature T1 plus delta T upon U. Now the lubricant can carry heat. Heat carried out by the lubricant will be M minus MS, M dot minus MS dot, because this quantity is comes in returning, M dot minus MS. So M dot minus MS into Cp into delta T, this is the heat carried out by the lubricant when it returns from the bearing, plus the heat carried out by the side leakage, and it will be MS Cp delta T upon 2, because the temperature difference is T1 plus delta T upon 2 minus T1. Because for the side leakage, intrinsic temperature is same T1, but returning temperature is T1 plus delta T upon 2 for the side leakage. So this equations comes. After solving these equations, just I have expressed the mass flow rate in density into Q volume flow rate. So by substituting this M by rho into Q, MS by rho into QS, and after rearranging the parameters, we get rho Cp delta T into Q into 1 minus 1 by 2 into QS upon Q. Again, this QS upon Q, the volumetric flow rate side leakage upon total volumetric flow rate at entering condition. This is the ratio. Again, this is the dimensionless ratio, and it has some important. We will see in next lecture what is the important of this. So here, heat carried out by the lubricant is expressed in by this equation for the case of side leakage. Now this concept, the heat carried out by the lubricant can be occur naturally or under pressure. Naturally in the case of general bearing, and under pressure when the requirement is to carry out the maximum heat loss. If the requirement is maximum heat loss, then under pressure this method is used. Now in case when sump or reservoir remains within the bearing, the sump can be positioned as a keyway like cavity in the bushing. Bushing is nothing, bush is nothing, it is the bearing. So in case of when the reservoir of or sump of lubricant is within the bearing, then heat is dissipated from the bearing surface, the second method. So now look, before going to explain the how is dissipated from the bearing surface, it is required to know some important types of how the lubricant is supplied into the bearing. Then we are able to understand the how heat is dissipated from the bearing surface in case of self-contained bearing, because sump is within the bearing, so it is called self-contained bearing. First, look here, self-contained bearing in which the warm lubricant stays within the bearing housing, and in this case lubricant is cooled within the housing by artificial cooling system. We will see this concept mathematically in next slide. First, I want to explain the how the lubricant is supplied into the bearing in case of self-contained bearing. Some frequently used lubricant supply methods. In the self-contained bearing, there are some types like oil ring, oil collar, splash, oil bath. These are types of lubricant supply in the self-contained bearing. in the oil ring, a ring is mounted on the journal or shaft. Generally, it is 1.5 to 2 times of the journal diameter. This ring brings oil to the top of the journal by grooves, or we can say spreader grooves, when it flows. To understand this, I would like to show you a figure. Yes, this is the figure of oil ring. This is the bearing. This is the bearing housing. And here, this is the shaft. Now, see here the cross section of this bearing. It is made in two halves because it is the self-contained bearing. So, a lubricant is required to replace time to time. So it is required to open the bearing, so it is made in two halves. If it is made in two halves, then this is the oil ring, this is the oil ring, this is the shaft, or you can say the journal. This is the oil seal. Oil seal means there is a seal such that so the lubricant or oil cannot pass from the bearing. It is sealed here, and due to this sealing, the lubricant always remains in the bearing. So it is a self-contained bearing. Now on the upper half, here's a groove is shown. This groove is to accommodate the oiling, because the diameter of ring is greater than the diameter of shaft. So it can be accommodated into this groove. When the shaft rotates or journal rotates, this ring, there is a lubricant on the bottom. These rings go to the bottom and takes the lubricant and splash on the bearing when it comes on top. There is some grooves on the bearing here. Some grooves also can be made here to carry the lubricant in other parts of the bearing. So this is the working of oil ring. Only here I want to say that how the ring carry the lubricant from the bottom to the top and it splash or circulated by the grooves within the bearing to the other parts of the bearing. And because the lubricant is within the bearing, so it is called self-contained bearing. This bearing time to time required to replace, and sometimes the temperature of this lubricant gets so high, some artificial cooling is also required. Only the heat dissipated from the bearing surface is not sufficient in some cases or in some applications. In that applications, in addition to the heat dissipated from the bearing surface, some artificial cooling by the coils of water, by the coils of air or other is in addition, that is also required. So one method is that to supply the lubricant. Another is oil collar. It is same like the ring. In place of ring, the collar is used. Somewhat similar arrangement as oil ring. A small upper reservoir of lubricant means the collar has a small upper reservoir. It is not the main reservoir. Main reservoir is on bottom. This is additional. From a small reservoir, oil flows by gravity through holes to the bearing surface. It is similar the oil ring, only the ring is replaced by the collar, and collar have a small buckets that is called these buckets. When these buckets come bottom of the bearing, it carries some lubricant, and when it goes to the top of the bearing, this lubricant which is filling the bucket, a small bucket, get flows in other parts of bearing by gravity. Another is express, same here, air expressed by rapidly moving parts due to the greater velocity of the journal, the air itself get expressed into the parts of bearing. Another is air bath. Here air bath is used because air being supplied by the virtue of partially submerged the journal in the air reservoir. To explain this, come to this figure. This is the figure of air bath. Here this is the journal, this is the bearing, and this journal is partially submerged into the lubricant. When the journal rotates, it itself carry the lubricant here and lubricate the parts of bearing. So this is called air bath. Here you can see that this is not the full journal bearing, it is the partial journal bearing, because the load carrying surface is only this is less than 180 degrees. Here also, in case of oil ring, here groove is made to accommodate the oil ring. So now this bearing part means top part, now it is not sufficient to carry the bearing load because it is discontinued here. Here the load carrying surface of bearing is bottom part, radial load acting on bottom part, because the top part get disturbed because it has a groove. So it is also a design point to see where the groove is made, because if the groove is made on that surface which bear the load, the bearing will fail. The bearing surface which carry the load don't get disturbed. So this is also the case of partial bearing. But in some adverse situation, when the load comes on the top surface of the bearing, this journal bearing can bear because this ring will support this surface, because the diameter of ring is larger than the diameter of journal. This ring may bear the load when in adverse condition the bearing load acts on the top surface. So there are so many parameters and so many situations required to know by the designer. Here some methods are explained how the lubricant is supplied in the self-contained bearing. Now you are able to know that in self-contained bearing the lubricant always remains inside the bearing, because here is the oil seal. When the lubricant is always within the bearing, it gets higher temperature time to time. When the operation continued, the temperature of lubricant always increased, so it is required to dissipate the heat from the bearing so that the temperature of lubricant cannot exceed a design parameter. In case of self-contained bearing, generally heat is dissipated from the bearing house by radiation and convection. In some situations, the dissipation is not sufficient to carry all the heat, then artificial cooling of housing is required. So first, here I would like to discuss how much heat is dissipated from the bearing house. Before going to explain this, I would like to explain little knowledge of groove. That groove is made on the bearing surface to circulate the lubricant. There are generally two types of grooves, that is the longitudinal grooves and that is the circumferential groove, longitudinal or axial groove. Here, first going to explain the groove, some students have inquired, sir, what is the bush and what is the bearing? They are same or different? Bush is nothing, it is the bearing material. Here intentionally I have made two types of bush here. The black color, this line is the bush. Here this black is also the bush. This is called plain bush because here this black line alone acts as a bearing. And the material of this bush is nothing, it is the bearing material. Bush is itself a bearing. Here this is the line bush and the line bush is supported by the another material, steel. This is the steel backing and this is the line bush, and again it is the material of this line bush is the bearing material. So bearing is nothing, it is the bush only. The bush itself is the bearing. So don't be confused the word bearing and bush. In some cases the backing is not required, there plain bearing is used. In some cases backing is required, and if you make the whole construction by the bearing material, it will be costly because it in some applications the whole material of bearing material is not required. In that case the material of lower cost can be used as a backing. So in case of line bush, some backing material, that is here it is steel, is used. So don't be confused with the bush and bearing. Now come to the main point, groove. The groove here, it is the axial groove because it is along the axis of the shaft or journal. Here a hole is made, that is the oil hole. From this hole the lubricant is goes into the bearing, and through this axial groove it get spread throughout the bearing surface. Here circumferential groove is made. This is the hole for the lubricant inlet, and when the oil comes into the bearing, it goes throughout the surface by this circumferential groove. And this circumferential groove is not made throughout the perimeter of the bearing, because if you make this groove throughout the perimeter of the bearing gets in two halves. It is not remains one bearing, it is in two halves. And another problem is that the load carrying capacity of bearing surface get decreased. So generally this circumferential groove is made in one side, either top side or bottom side, and which side the groove has to be made, it depends upon the load is carried out by which side. If load is carried out by the bearing on top side, the groove will be in bottom side. If the bearing load acting on the bearing surface on bottom side, then this groove will be on top side. Generally because lubricant remains bottom side, so load carrying surface of bearing is generally on the bottom side and groove is made on top side. This is some explanation of groove. Here it is written, lubricant enters the groove through the oil hole flows either by gravity or under pressure to cover the whole surface of the hole. Now you are able to know that these are the methods to supply the lubricants in self-contained bearing, and now you are able to imagine in self-contained bearing the lubricant always remains inside the bearing. So in that case, heat is dissipated from the bearing surface. Now come to the how much heat is dissipated. This is a heat dissipated at outer surface of bearing. At equilibrium, when the heat generated, rate of heat generated is same as the rate of heat dissipated, at that condition means at equilibrium, this relation occurs, heat generated equal to heat dissipated. Now the heat dissipated from the bearing surface will be, heat dissipated HD will be CaTb minus Ta, where C, you know that C is the heat dissipation coefficient. It is the same you have studied in the heat transfer, overall heat transfer coefficient. This is nothing, it is the overall heat transfer coefficient in heat transfer. Here it is written heat dissipation coefficient. The unit is watt per meter square per degree centigrade. A is projected area of bearing and it is L into D, length of bearing into diameter of journal. Because the clearance between bearing and journal is very small in microns, so diameter of journal can be taken as the diameter of bearing. So here projected area of bearing is L into D. Tb minus Ta, change in temperature. Tb is the temperature of bearing surface and Ta is the temperature of surrounding air, means we can say the ambient temperature, because heat is transferred to the surrounding, so here ambient temperature is used. So heat dissipated will be simply CaTb minus Ta. This Tb minus Ta here written, Tb minus Ta can be written as half To minus Ta. What is To? To is the temperature of oil field, means the temperature of lubricant in the bearing, and this is called operating temperature of bearing. Ta is the ambient temperature. About this equation I will explain later. Here you know that the heat dissipated equal to CaTb minus Ta, because heat is transferred from the bearing surface to the ambient or surrounding air. So Tb minus Ta here, A is the projected area, L into D, and C is the heat dissipation coefficient, just like the overall heat transfer using the heat transfer concept. Now some modifications or rearrangement of parameter is done here because it is required to know about the what is C, what will be the value of C, and what will be the value of Tb minus Ta, means bearing temperature and ambient temperature. This will vary with different of, this will be different in different applications in for the different lubricant. So this is required, the value of this parameter is given in design data book for different application and different lubricant in term of C double dash. So this equation is written in term of C double dash because C double dash is given in design data book. HD CaTb minus Ta. A is the projected area, so it can be written C into L into D into Tb minus Ta. Now this parameter C into L into D, this parameter C into Tb minus Ta can be written as C double dash. C double dash is nothing, it is a C into Tb minus Ta. So this equation can be written as HD equal to C double dash into LD. Okay, this parameter is only defined to see the value in design data book, C double, because in design data book the C double dash is given, and the C double dash is the C into TB minus TA. So to use this equation, you must remember that in design data book C double dash is given in joule per second per mm square. The unit of C double dash in design data was given joule per second per mm square. So always put L and D in mm, so that the multiplication of L into D becomes mm square, and this mm square and this mm square can be cancelled out, and rest unit joule per second is the unit of heat dissipated. So now heat dissipated can be written as C double dash into LD. L is the length of bearing and D is the diameter of channel. This equation Hg means heat generated equal to heat dissipated from the bearing surface occurs only at equilibrium. When this does not occur, then again Hg upon H parameter is defined, that is called temperature rise parameter, and this is practically observed in major of cases. Now I would like to explain this TO, because it is very important temperature. TO is the temperature of lubricant or oil in the bearing. So this generally the temperature of oil in the bearing get increased, and due to the heat transfer from lubricant or oil to the bearing surface, heat is transferred to the bearing surface, and from the bearing surface it transferred to the ambient temperature, means surrounding. First the heat is increased, means the temperature of lubricant get increased. This heat first transferred to the bearing surface, and from the bearing surface it is transferred to the surrounding. So there some relation exists. It is based on the experimental result that TO is the temperature of oil film, or you can say the temperature of lubricant. TO is the temperature of lubricant or oil. TO minus TB equal to alpha, some constant, into TB minus TA. This alpha is a constant depending upon the lubrication scheme and the bearing housing geometry. So there is no need to go in deep about the alpha. In most of cases this alpha is 1, means it is assumed that the whole heat is transferred from the lubricant to bearing, and the whole heat from the bearing surface transferred to the ambient temperature, means surrounding. So in most cases the value of this alpha will be 1. If the value of alpha is 1, then this equation becomes TO minus TB equal to TB minus TA. Now this can be written as 2TB equal to TO plus TA. Now the TB minus TA used in this equation TB minus TA can be written as, from here TB, TO upon 2 plus TA upon 2 minus TA, and it becomes half of TO minus TA. So this heat dissipated can be written as C into A into, in place of TB minus TA we can use half of TO minus TA, because generally the temperature of lubricant can be measured, TO minus TA. We have neither use of this equation nor this equation. We have only use of this equation HD equal to C double dash into LD. But you must know how this equation comes up, because we need the value of C TB minus TA, it is given in design data book in term of C double dash, and C double dash is nothing C into TV minus T. So we have use of this equation to calculate the heat dissipated, HD equal to C double dash into LD. Now, if temperature of lubricant is higher than the temperature of bearing, after heat transfer means heat generated is dissipated to the surrounding. After that, if the temperature of lubricant remains higher than the temperature of bearing, then it is cooled by the circulation of water. The lubricant is cooled by the circulation of water through coil, and that is called artificial cooling. And generally, this is the case in industrial applications, because there, due to the heavy application or heavy use, generally the temperature lubricant remains higher than the bearing. So only single method heat dissipation from the bearing surface does not work. There an additional cooling is required, and that is called artificial cooling. Now, okay, how the C double dash is seen in the design data book? This parameter C double dash, this is again the design data book of Mahadevan. This is taken from the Mahadevan design data book. Here, if you see the design data book, there are two graphs here. There is a two graph. In the both graph, two curves is plotted, and it is named as 1 and 2. One is for well ventilated bearing, and two is unventilated bearing. But the difference is that here it is the graph for C dash. C dash is the another parameter. I have defined C double dash. If you remember, in this equation, I have defined C double dash. So this C double dash is given in bottom graph. This is the graph for C double dash. So we have, I want to say that my students, that you don't follow this graph, you follow this graph, because I have written the equation in term of C double dash, and this is the graph for C double dash. What is C dash? We can easily see in the design data book how this C dash is defined. But in this lecture, I have defined the term C double dash, so you use this graph. Here on y axis, temperature rise is plotted, TB minus TA. TB is the temperature of bearing, and TA is the temperature of surrounding, means ambient temperature. And on x axis, C double dash is given. So suppose our bearing is well ventilated, so this first curve has to be used. Now suppose the TB minus TA is suppose 20 degree. Corresponding to this 20 degree, we can easily see what will be the value of C double dash. Okay. This is the graph for one lubricant. Similar graph is available for different types of lubricant. But in our course, BTEC course, we have to use this only graph for all types of lubricant. Now, to see the C double dash, first you must have the value of TB minus TA. Then only you can able to see the value of C double dash. So this TB minus TA is calculated by here TB minus TA. I have explained that this TB minus TA can be calculated by this equation, half of TO minus TA. Ambient temperature is always known, it is around the 35 degrees centigrade, and the temperature of air you have to calculate. Then you are able to calculate TB minus TA, because you can't calculate the temperature of inner surface of the bearing directly. TB is the temperature of bearing, means temperature of inner surface of the bearing, but we are able to measure the temperature of lubricant in the bearing because it can be measured, and generally it is assumed that the temperature of lubricant in the bearing is the average of the temperature of lubricant going when it is keep in the bearing, and when it is highly heated. I will explain this in the numerical example more detail, but we have to use this equation to calculate the TB minus TA. After calculating TB minus TA, we can see the value of C double dash from this graph. Okay, now from this graph, always remember that we have to use this graph to calculate the C double dash, not this graph. This is for the C dash, and C dash is the another parameter. I have defined only C double dash here. Now, at last, in the last of the lecture, I would like to explain how the lubrication is complex. It is not easy. It is not very easy task to lubricate the entire system where the moving part is. To show the complexity of the lubrication, I have picked a picture of IC engine. Here we can see this is the oil passage in piston engine or compressor. Now we can see in this, okay, this is the hole made for the lubricant in oil. In from this here and here, oil is go inside and it lubricates the first main bearing. This is the main bearing here and here. This is the main bearing, and to lubricate the main bearing, there is the another hole here. This is the circumferential groove in main bearing. From this groove, it lubricates the whole surface of the main bearing here. Main bearing. After that, some part of the lubricant goes through the drilled passage in crankshaft to the connecting rod. From there, some lubricant goes to the connecting rod through the drilled passage in crankshaft. Now, here it is the bearing. So the part of lubricant which goes to the connecting rod, here that part lubricate this bearing of connecting rod. It is through the circumferential groove, and from there some part of that lubricant goes through this passage to the piston pin or wrist pin. Here in some application, this passage is called raffle drilled passage in connecting rod. In some cases this is not available, in most cases it is not available. In that case, from this bearing the lubricant goes through the splashing to the piston pin. I have explained earlier what is splash. Is it goes by splashing to the piston pin in absence of raffle drilled passage. So we can observe how the complexity occurs in lubrication of bearing. Okay, I think you have enjoyed this lecture. In next lecture, I will explain how the bearing is designed. Bearing is designed on the basis of some dimensionless parameter, and in the bearing design, the important parameter is how the heat is generated and how the heat is dissipated. That means how the temperature is raised within the bearing. The temperature rise in the bearing only is the main parameter which affects the performance of bearing, because if the temperature rise in the bearing is large, it deteriorate, or you can say that it adversely affect the lubricant. And when the lubricant affected adversely, the film formation get affected, and by the film get affected badly, the performance of bearing